Dear friends, good evening. Thank you for coming. We are having the second event as part of the field research project, If Our Soup Can Could Speak, which is going to be about Mikhail Lifshitz's work. If you want to get information about these particular events, if you want to subscribe to Dima and David's texts and information, then you should leave your contact details. And now I would like to give the floor to David Riff and Dmitry Gutov, who will show us the way into Karl Marx's aesthetics. Hello, thank you for coming. I should say that our project is dedicated to the book The Crisis of Ugliness. You might have heard about it already. And this book is the most famous, the most disputable book of Mikhail Lifshitz. And it's a very important historic document to a very important time period. It's a document of cultural change, a turning point, a breakthrough document, the conservative turning point. It was published in 1968, that expressed the new party line. And the turning towards conservatism. But it was quite an ambivalent book in a way that it gave a special vision to the aesthetics of modernism, to many generations of artists. And this book, The Crisis of Ugliness, even today seems very intriguing because it gives the alternative history of art very radically critically, and it's very different from the canonic way that we got used to think of modernism. So, from the art history point of view, it's a tremendously important book. And we believe that The Crisis of Ugliness is much broader than that. It's not just about art polemics or some expression of some official position. Even though when it was published for the first time, this was the perception. So it's like Dr. Strangelove by Stanley Kubrick, Doomsday Device. So it's a secret weapon for artists that work nowadays. Because they are still the hostages of modernist institutions. It's the guide of for the perplexed. It's a philosophical book. And one of our hypotheses in our art research is that the philosophy of this book and the philosophical meaning of this book is very relevant today. And we can identify it using different art means. And we want to emphasize this fundamental philosophical level and not just the details of philosophical narrative, which makes this book extremely important. And you can see how fundamental Lifshitz approaches the question. If you just look at Dima, who is sitting next to me today, who is a great expert in Lifshitz, so he said last time that when you take a look at one of the articles of this book, you can see this fundamental philosophical meaning, and that article is called Phenomenology of the Soup Can, and there's an allusion to Hegel's Phenomenology of the Spirit. And you should know that Lifshitz was a great expert in Hegel, and He was the editor of three volumes of Hegel's Aesthetics. So he wrote a foreword, and then he changed the translation. Worked on the translation. So this fact gives a hint as to how important this book is. If you know, Hegel's Aesthetics consists of three volumes, and the second and the third are the examples and elaboration of some art material, not just an illustration, but concretization of his theory. So you can see that Hegel's theory is not just the vision of some ideals that are implemented later on through divine spirits, but basically they are social phenomena. And so this material makes Hegel's Aesthetics extremely interesting. And why am I talking about this? Because the Crisis of Ugliness is the second and the third volume of some particular aesthetics, because it's an example of more general theory, more abstract theory that Lifshitz was developing. And this is his main contribution into science, and he started working on it 40 years before. So it means it has some specific development of his work, because historical Lifshitz was the first researcher that began to create entire reconstruction of Marx's aesthetic views. So he was involved in textual archaeology. He was not just applying the Marxist theory, the Marxist critique of political economy to culture and art as ideology. He identified the aesthetics that he could see between the lines in Marx's texts, and it's a very unusual view, because it's not often that Marx was, it's not always considered that Marx was aesthetic philosopher. So Lifshitz considers Marx as a hidden philosopher of art, with an art theory of his own tucked away between the lines of his texts, and the theory that runs counter to the early modernisms of Marx's own day, and continues to provide a critical key, but also an aesthetic alternative to an art of reduction, subtraction, destruction, and ex nihilo creation. And his theory was contrary to the theories of his time. It was anti-modernist theory. It was an alternative to modernism that was at the forefront during those days. And his lifetime project lasted more than 40 years. And so he was working on that research throughout his life. You probably heard about the results of such research if you visited the previous lecture. But one of the main result is the collection on literature and art, Marx and Engels on literature and art. This was an anthology, and the philosophy of art of Karl Marx.
вышло в 70-е годы и называлось тогда Карл Маркс «Искусство и общественный идеал». Там
also art and social ideal was another book
на английском языке «The Philosophy of Art of Karl Marx».
Was published later.
На которой он тоже параллельно работал и дорабатывал, на самом деле, который он когда он писал тексты, которые собраны в кризис безобразия.
He was completing that work while writing the Crisis of Ugliness. So we can see some correlations in terms of time. It means that this person was working on three fundamental works. The one was the book on Marx's aesthetic views. The second was re-edition of Hegel's Aesthetics, and the third was the Crisis of Ugliness. That's why I wanted to draw a comparison between those things.
Понимать, почему именно
to understand why
классического и над материалом the,
that this material of classical modernism and neo-avant-garde was something that Lifshitz wanted to focus upon to concretize his Marxist aesthetic through a radically critical analysis. And so it's important to understand that Lifshitz began his art career as a student at Vkhutemas when he encountered different modernisms of his time.
And
he had to learn a lot of things by heart. And so he was exposed to the conflicting modernisms of his day, and he rejected it early on. But his teachers recognized his talent for Leninism, and even though he didn't have a complete higher education, he was hired as a student adjunct and later as a lecturer in dialectical materialism. And he was out of line with other trends that were at Vkhutemas at that time. And
так что, чтобы понять вообще, то есть вот отвержение модернизма и критика модернизма, часть жизни проекта самого начала, но также некая тесная связь вообще некий,
скажем так,
общий
опыт, own experience. So it's important to get back to his very early publications in order to understand his views. So I would like to get down to close readings. And
this journal называется, по-моему, журнал кафедра
This text was published by the chair of social sciences at Vkhutemas. It was published there, but it went through a lot of censorship, so there are many references to avant-garde, Soviet avant-garde that he polemicized. And in order to understand the crisis of ugliness, it's very important to get back there in order to understand what Lifshitz thought about production art, how he positioned himself as a conservative person.
Действительно разобрался в этом, хотел
понять,
хотел логику
wanted to understand the logics, and so that he could outline his own point of view that could be more utopical than the line taken by Vkhutemas at that time. And from the very beginning, it is clear that Lifshitz is addressing the main question and discussion at the Vkhutemas. So Vkhutemas was an incredibly advanced institution whose students developed different theories like Krutikov theory or flying cities, those cities that could fly using nuclear energy that didn't exist at that time. So it was a place of futurologic thinking in a country that was underdeveloped, that was undergoing industrialization, trying to catch up with the global trends. So what is art in this situation of such big fundamental changes in social life? So does it go forward just like avant-garde artists thought, or is it lagging behind? And as you can probably understand that today this question is still very relevant when the world undergoes drastic changes. As Lifshitz points out in his article, Marx had already addressed these questions. And he addressed these questions in a very special way. So anyone wanting to understand this question would have to go back to Marx. And Marx gave a completely different view from the Marxists that were working at Vkhutemas. So Dima is my assistant today, so I feel like a magician. And now I should get some rabbits and hired, and Dmitry Gutov is going to read the first quotation that Lifshitz that comes first in that Lifshitz article. So this is the quotation from Lifshitz. Among many other things, the famous introduction to the critique of political economy offers an interpretation of the principal question of scientific aesthetics, that of the evolution of artistic value in its connection to broader social evolution. Marx dedicated a series of notes to the solution of this problem, which today are the main source for the reconstruction of his aesthetic views. He writes, in the case of the arts, it is well known that certain periods of their flowering are out of all proportion to the general development of society, hence also to the material foundation, the skeletal structure, as it were, of its organization. For example, the Greeks compared to the moderns, or also Shakespeare, the end of quotation. It is comparatively easy to explain this discrepancy between the development of productive forces and the development of art. It is clear, for example, that Greek art and Greek mythology cannot exist under the conditions of highly developed industry, where the brew of Shakespeare's witches seems far less potent than the poisons produced by modern chemistry. The difficulty lies in deriving some general law from all the contradictions between the different forms of art and the constant development of productive forces. The difficulty consists only in the general formulation of these contradictions. So this general wording was something that the theoreticians of the 20th century were interested in. And this quotation from Grundris, the introduction to the critique of political economy, was very famous at that time because it was discussed by different people that made different conclusions. And in one of the articles that had been written 1 year before Lifshitz wrote his article, the left critic Boris Arvatov wrote an article, Karl Marx and Art Restoration, or art sociologist Vladimir Fritsche. They both used that quotation and they interpreted it in their own way. So it means that there were some people that tried to formulate certain laws about the relationship between socioeconomic development and art. And Lifshitz means that these are not just laws of nature, there are also certain rules of behavior. He means that these laws are enforced. Which means you can't break this law, because they have regulatory meaning.
На самом деле, действительно, в Vkhutemasе был такой климат, что если ты нарушаешь некие законы,
so at Vkhutemas, for example, anyone who broke these laws could be expelled, could become a pariah.
Произошло с Лифшицем в 29 году.
This didn't happen to Lifshitz in 1929 when he had to abandon his position.
Все-таки не только
So,
these
two laws that Lifshitz speaks about are, first of all, the law of economic primacy, which Lifshitz associates with the widely popular views of Fritsche. And the second law is the law of art's demise, which Lifshitz ascribes to the so-called left. As Lifshitz points out, these laws contradict one another, even if they are often found in the same modernist camp in paradoxical fusion. So on the one hand, the law of economic primacy, meaning that art thrives in the most highly developed societies. It reflects the high level of development at the base. So there's the superstructure, the ideology, then there's the base, which is definitive. And from this point of view, it means that Marx's quote means that Greek art was the most developed society, both technologically and socially. So they were the most advanced civilization of their time. And so their art was most developed. But with the passage of time, that primacy erodes. So this is the theory of mechanical definition of superstructure through the base.
после конца военного коммунизма.
And we can imagine why this would appeal to Vkhutemas students after the end of war communism, at a time when the new socialist state was trying to compete with private enterprise and traditional social structure, presenting itself as a streamlined corporation and a bringer of progress in leaps and bounds, artists using the newest art, and there are so many illusions of progress and technological development that can be seen at Vkhutemas. So it looks like a desire for technological progress. So it's more like a technological desire. And when the Crisis of Ugliness was written, this could be felt in many different texts. For example, the texts that justify the new American painting. You can always read that America is the most developed, the most advanced country in the world, so finally they have the most developed and the advanced art. So this idea was very relevant in the 60s as well as nowadays. Because we can think of many different cases when, you know, people think that HD projections or AD cameras make art better. That the advanced that in the advanced West or in Asia you can find better art than here in Russia. So this is one of the positions. And it's very surprising to see that nowadays, 100 years later, nothing has changed much. And you can find it in many participatory projects or communicative projects in the fetishization of communication and reproduction technologies. And also you can see it in some Chinese museums with the best light, but the content is not so good, and so it's again the idea that good technologies, good infrastructure will automatically provide us with great art, but it's not true.
Скажем так, не капитализм, а современность и прогресс растворяют всю идеологию.
On the other hand, there is the position of the end of art. Capitalism dissolves all ideology, including that of aesthetic production. So technical progress erodes its presuppositions and mythologies, its all the sciences, its pictorial means, its optics. Everything is negated by time and lost in the currents of history. And Boris Arvatov, this is how Boris Arvatov read this quotation of Marx, and he made Marx an apologist of the end of art.
And Arvatov
also uses another famous aesthetic passage in Marx's work, the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. And here, classical art is a historical costume worn by the bourgeoisie during the revolutions. And Arvatov says that Marx was happy that the old art disappeared. And Arvatov sees Marx as a precursor for his own production aesthetics. Here, aesthetic practice
двигается далеко за рамками станковой живописи,
beyond easel painting or novels, or other traditional forms, moves beyond art into production, into everyday life, where it transforms the whole life. So, art is no longer there. It's there are only some aesthetic practices. So you can see only work of aesthetic thinking over transformation of everyday life.
And идея о том, что есть некий закон, что технология разрушает все.
So this law that the technology destroys what art used to be, and it proved to be very tough. For example, realistic painting could no longer be after photography appeared. This was the most dumb version.
Очень часто встречаются в 20 веке, особенно в 60-е годы, когда на самом деле
идея
получила целое новое второе дыхание.
This idea got second life in the 60s, because it was renewed in the new avant-garde. And we can think of the Nouveau Realists in France or Kaprov's happenings, but most of all Fluxus and the Situationists, both of which had strong neo-productionist aspects. They said that we have to walk out into life. So, just like in productive art, nobody wanted to call themselves artists. The same happened in the 60s. So this concept of the end of art was spreading actively among many people, especially among curators and activists, artists. When they just import different phenomena from social activism and exhibit it as the work of art, like 5 or 6 years ago, we saw Artur Zhmijevsky at Polish Biennial. He filled in the bottom floor with Occupy, and so it means that Occupy, the political movement, was exhibited as post art, representing the helplessness of art.
And so,
I have explained this opposition that the technological advanced society could produce great art, but on the other hand, there's no art, so they come together very well in order to provide the background for different modernist practices. And Lifshitz says that the first law, the law of economic primacy, is easy to disprove. His favorite example is that of Venetian painting. Which only attained primacy once Venetian economy declined. And we could look at our own technological possibilities. You know, artists now can work with different technologies for K projections, but all that doesn't do anything for art. So we don't see any great or epic works. And the second law, Lifshitz says, is also wrong. It contains some grains of truth, but the big objection to the left is that it rejoices in the demise of art as we know it. And what's more, he doesn't say this, that it rejoices along with Marx. And they don't ask why it happens.
So
Lifshitz opposes two of his own laws that he could read in Marx's works. The one is quite general and is not very useful to understand art. It's the art of the negation of the form. He says the art is changing, so everything changes. Cultural forms are constantly shifting. Just like Heraclitus said, you can't enter the same river twice. Everything is in constant flow. Even if you thought that some social form was alive. So social forms are rendered obsolete, even if they were only just alive, irreversibly gone with the wind. And now I would like Dima to read the next quotation. So this is the Lifshitz's idea about the eternal negation of forms. So that's his quote. This is the eternal negation of forms inherent to any developmental process. Yesterday I was happy, but every yesterday is followed by today. Thus my happiness must disappear for me to keep existing. What a tragedy, very much in the spirit of those theoreticians who assert that the forces of production cannot make one single step without killing art in the process. In reality, however, the tragedy is not so great. Tomorrow I could be happy again, maybe not like yesterday, but happy nonetheless. When you grow out of beautiful clothes, you step into an irreconcilable contradiction to them, no matter how beautiful they are. But you do not step into a contradiction with clothing as such. That is, you do not go naked if you still have the possibility of replacing your old clothes with new ones that fit. The same holds true for art. Greek sculpture or Renaissance painting are impossible to revive, but this would not be such a tragedy if the highly developed conditions of modern society could replace the art forms of the past something equal in aesthetic strength and significance. So, if capitalist society is the most economically developed of all the past social formations, why is it incapable of creating a commensurate expression in art? Sadly, the eternal law of the negation of form holds no explanation, nor does any other eternal or general law. Only the study of capitalist society's concrete particulars can help us to decide this question. I would like to make one comment on this quote, because so that it was clear that it doesn't have any archaeological nature for us. So it's obvious that we are living in more progressive, more developed time as compared to the past. So why does the contemporary world see its reflection in that, in Duchamp pissoir, in other bathroom tools? Why, instead of medieval icon painting, do we have bathroom equipment? And Lifshitz gets back to this question later. But before that, he formulates another law, which is more specific and less general. And so another law is that of the precondition of material production for art. So there is actually something like progress, or material progress that artists make use of, because artists use material means of their time. So they use modern technologies, and this is good, because thus they can express human achievements. A certain level of prosperity or success is a must for art to develop. Only through the objectively unfolded wealth of human can the wealth of human sensibility flourish. So this technical process reveals human sensibility. And here Lifshitz quotes the Paris manuscripts of 1844. And this was a very early quotation of Marx's works that was not known to the wider public. It was an early Marx who was a romantic that wrote those manuscripts. So he was speaking about human senses like ear or eye, and these senses developed collectively, and it is here that Marx develops the idea that there are many things that developed at that time because it involved the five senses progressing and developed not subjectively but collectively historically as the work of all previous history. So Marx says, sense, which is a prisoner of crude practical need, has only a restricted sense. This is especially for our productionists. For a man who is starving, the human form of food does not exist. The man who is burdened with worries and needs has no sense for the finest of plays.
Здесь интересно, что к сведению нашим производственникам Маркс Лившиц ссылается напрямую на производственное искусство.
So Lifshitz
бросают им некий упрек. То есть на самом деле этот упрек нацелен на утилитаризм производственного искусства, на заявление, что
reproaches the productionists, which aims at their utilitarianism and their desire to first fulfill and command basic needs. He tells them that they are restricting themselves.
Ну, отвлеченной позы художника и наконец-то сами стать
so
работниками культуры, да, конструкторами, которые определяют самые базовые такие формы
builders that identify the basic forms of
вот
reality.
На такой грубую да, как это да, в грубой практической потребности, да, можно и смотреть на искусство 60-х годов.
So speaking
видеть,
about crude practical
так,
need is something
вещи,
we can see in art
of
the 60s, and we can criticize many things from Marx's point of view. For example, minimalist art, which sometimes describes constructivism as the art of the Cold War. And they identify themselves as ABC art or the art of primary structures that was applied to minimalism in the 60s. So if you deal only with some crude practical need, then the feeling would be just as crude.
Надо сказать, что это, то есть это довольно специфический уже закон,
and, it's,
который
quite a specific law.
Все-таки ставит перед художником задачу не
that,
заниматься
artist not just to deal with some basic needs and the eternity, but to look at the time where they live and work with their surroundings and get some valuable things or just deal with the problems that they face.
Lifshitz говорит, что чтобы на самом деле разобраться,
Lifshitz says, in order to figure out all those laws, in order to work with them, you should look at a different aspect of Marx's theory. This is the general theory of progress, which is described in the mode of production. And this is structuring principles found on all levels of social production, ranging from everyday business transactions to art. And Marx identified four modes of production
in
broad strokes,
картины, которые потом, ну, последующие теоретики больше развивали.
And they were developed by other theoreticians later. So the first one is the Asiatic or Asiatic despotic mode of production, the ancient, the feudal, and the modern bourgeois mode of production.
Для Маркса после этого был бы,
which is lasting until today. For Marx,
способ производства социализма, коммунизму, об этих способах производства она особенно в ранних работах не очень.
The socialist mode of production would be transitioned to something else.
Дальше текст как бы идет по этим способам производства, пытаясь объяснить,
so,
в чем суть
искусства
этих разных.
Is elaborating on the essence of art at different historic times. So, beginning with the Asiatic despotic mode of production that existed before classical antiquity, that existed unbroken for centuries.
Грубое отношение нужды к природе.
held back by crude relation of necessity to nature.
Человечество на самом деле держалось, так сказать, held back. To be held back by something. Sorry. Да, удерживался. Да. То есть человечество не могло дальше развиваться из-за очень грубое отношение нужды к природе.
Held back by crude relation of necessity to nature. Blood ties. Was something that kept people at the same place, and it was on the constant verge of despotism. So there was one despot, and so everybody had to obey him. So repressed personality, no individuation, with an uninterrupted everyday of cyclical, prehistoric, mythical time. And great public works took place during the time when the pyramids were created, when temples were built, and this can be identified with Hegel's concept of the symbolic form of art, because there's symbolic, classical, and romantic forms of art that Hegel identified. So when the personal spirit is not well developed and was something that made people feel alienated from those huge and great works of art that they considered to be created by some divine powers. When Lifshitz wrote that text, art was very popular. The Egyptian art or art of Mesopotamia, because of its collectivity and its monumentality, were very popular in the early Soviet Union as a expression of collective mode of living. So Lifshitz was writing about this, and then he described the ancient mode of production. At some point, the prehistoric communities dissolve, and the personality began to develop as private property emerges in some form. And individuals are freed from blood ties, then money begins to circulate, and there is a separation of utility from its immediate predatory form, which fosters a selfless relation to the form of things, and the emergence of artworks proper, statues and painting with individuated human bodies with real physical characteristics.
Социальным явлением тоже. Да? Они могут, например, вот через это бескорыстное отношение, они могут, например, тоже смотреть на формы.
Through the selfless relation, they can observe the form of a human body selflessly. The human body with real physical characteristics and not with some effects that oppresses the personality.
Миметического искусства, изобразительное искусство. Здесь мы действительно должны делать связь с классическим искусством.
And we should identify this with Hegel's classical art, the art of ancient Greece, the art of truth and beauty, both for Hegel and Lifshitz, where veracity and idealization first appear, from where they continue to define art until those years Lifshitz is writing from. So classical art offers an example of a direct proportion between economics and art. But you shouldn't draw hasty conclusions, say Lifshitz.
Потому что, говорит Лившиц, и это очень интересно, на самом деле, для понимания его общей теории.
And it's very interesting to see what he says in order to understand his whole theory.
В истории человечества невероятно уязвимый
he says that,
переходной момент в истории.
Classical
Он говорит, что на самом деле
art is vulnerable.
В древнегреческом искусстве есть очень много элементов символического.
He says that there are lots of symbolic elements in ancient Greek art.
Когда начинается распад вот этого общества,
and
тут
so,
что-то выявляется какое-то другое отношение. Но как только этот распад совершается,
during the collapse
искусство уже
of society,
тоже идет на убыль. То есть на самом деле мы говорим о очень маленьком отрезке,
goes into decline.
Очень большом развитии, который такой почти как зазор или как шель в истории.
So,
и
we speak about a short period of time,
важна.
And actually
Все,
there is this gap, and it's very important for
Lifshitz. Человеческой истории у Лифшица выходит из как раз таких транзиторных, да, таких
because,
перехода.
These transitory periods are very important when the society moves through different stages.
Греческое искусство, классическое искусство, античность.
And
и эта идея, на самом деле, которой Лифшиц будет возвращаться очень много раз.
There are these short interludes, transitional phases, historical interims or gaps. And Лифшиц gets back to these gaps. Very often, because for his own work, he sees such a gap in the 1930s, in the brief interim between the Cultural Revolution in 1928 to 1932 and the rise of the Terror in 1936-37. So this was the period when Lifshitz wrote the most important things in his life. We can take a look at Cubism if we want to get back to the Crisis of Ugliness as this transitory point of time, so a time between a long 19th century and bloody 20th century, so this short interim phase when modernism could reach its classical stage. And Lifshitz says that you have to take a closer look to see what changes into what. It's not that every interim period can generate great art.
Кубизм является некой классикой
модернизма,
и он это признает.
So, for example, Cubism's emergence between 1905 and 1912 can be seen as an interim conducive to the emergence of paradigmatic classical art.
За него это тоже восполнить эту мысленную. Далее. Лифшиц говорит, что он не может обсуждать феодальный способ.
Then Lifshitz says he can't discuss the feudal mode of production, and there's very interesting connection between art and the production. But he decides to skip it, and so he moves to the capitalist mode of production.
Это ровно противоположное к тому, что было, так сказать, в азиатской деспотической древности.
So the bourgeois modern mode of production seems exactly the opposite of the Asiatic despotic mode, a completely atomized society, bereft of the traditions holding people back from millennia.
Держали людей на месте тысячелетиями, что-то динамически развивающее, но, говорит Лифшиц, вообще противоположные часто совпадают.
But the opposites coincide, says Lifshitz. The unbroken everyday returns
and
capitalism with a vengeance. As everything is subverted to the profit motive and the need for money.
И нужды денег. Да. Самым главным sorry. Я тут терял свое место, извините. То есть вот здесь уже такая идея идет, что это капиталистическое искусство, это буржуазное искусство.
So this capitalist art, bourgeois art, is all about money and gains, and this is contradictory to the idea of art.
Частная собственность сделала нас
Private property has made us so stupid and one-sided that an object is only ours when we have it, when it exists for us as capital, or when we directly possess, eat, drink, wear, inhabit it, etc., in short, when we use it. Therefore, all the physical and intellectual senses have been replaced by the simple estrangement of all these senses, the sense of having. So that it might give birth to its inner wealth. Human nature had to be reduced to this absolute poverty, and further down, the supersession of private property is therefore the complete emancipation of all human senses and attributes.
На самом деле отношения, да, на котором базировалось по теории не только Лифшица.
So this selfless relation that was the basis for art is impossible in modern society. And the emancipation from private property may open a true utopian horizon of the emancipation of all human senses and attributes.
У Лифшица очень сильный, такое сильное именно в это время тоже появляется впервые утопическое мышление о том,
and,
как
Lifshitz, later reading of this utopian horizon would amount to a complete actualization of what he saw as a revolutionary humanist legacy, promoting that selfless human relation to the world of things, thanks to the wealth of human development and beyond selfish motives. So this has to do with feelings and senses of people, that something that is not related to money.
Автобиография идеи Лифшица написана в 70-е годы.
There is a quote from Autobiography of Idea written by Lifshitz. He wrote, all true art in the past bears the stamp of communism, or at least can be translated into the language of communism.
И видеть его истинный смысл, освобождающий, но за это должно быть абсолютно бескорыстное к нему отношение.
So,
нельзя просто себе присвоить
все. Это selfless attitude.
Напротив, присвоение.
You can't appropriate it.
Надо сказать, this is something contrary to that. Очень важен
This utopian horizon is very important to understand Lifshitz's criticism of modernism.
Такой скучный, самый посредственный академизм, если вот ему дают выбор между модернизмом.
So he keeps to this ideal of a new art backed by the reclaimed wealth of history, and notes again and again that it is not identical to a bland conventional academism. Anyone familiar with my work knows academism is not my ideal. So people have to understand what real academism means in order to create real art of modernity after liberating from private property.
Это важно тоже понять для позиционирования Лифшица внутри Вхутемаса, потому что
And it's very important to understand the positioning of Lifshitz inside Vkhutemas, because it's not that he joins real conservative people, like Acher and other realists, academicians, because he could be a theoretician of Acher. But he doesn't do it. He develops his own position, so he goes out of avant-garde, but not to the field of realism.
Таким образом, вообще Маркс открывает такой лейтмотив в марксовой критике политической экономики, что корыстное отношение к вещам через частный собственность открывает
Lifshitz identifies a leitmotif of Marx's critique of political economy. The selfish relation introduces new forms of symbolic abstraction, new forms of slavery, new forms of blind collectivity. And this becomes part of economy in itself. It leads to new forms of slavery and new forms of blind collectivity.
Когда начинает разобраться в источниках Марксов общей теории, увидит, что
when he later examines Marx's own reading,
который вы найдете поначалу
of Asiatic despotic fetishism, that can be found in the first volume of Capital.
So
this theory is based on the ancient forms of fetishism that can be found in Mesopotamia or Egypt. So that were so powerful there. So what is fetishism? Is worship. It's the worship of crude necessity. As a man-made, godlike, inhuman presence that determines human life.
То есть, это идея такая, что вот это возвращение древнего способа производства азиатского деспотического
the return of the ancient Asiatic despotic mode of the production should be overcome in the future. And now I want you to read one more key quotation.
Мы подходим к самому принципиальному моменту. Цитата очень короткая.
So it's going to be a very short quote.
Особенность хозяйственного прогресса в капиталистическом
of economic progress under capitalism subjugates everything to the dominance of profiteering on display and never-ending cynicism in equating the most beautiful palaces to mountains of boxes of shoe polish. So equating the most beautiful palaces to the mountains of boxes of shoe polish. So this wording is extremely important in order to understand Lifshitz's aesthetics and his interests, both in the 20s and 30s and 60s.
And here we
see not only his relation to avant-garde. It's not that we, have to make this box of shoe polish as beautiful as a palace should be, because this is an example of productive art. Making the reality different, full of life, make this box of shoe polish our friend.
Но и еще, конечно, здесь видно, откуда такое отношение, например, ну не только к ready-made Дюшана, а, например, такому художнику, как Энди Уорхол,
we can see why there is this attitude not to much say Дюшан, but also Andy Warhol. Brillo pads, this cleaning. He made those boxes, put a brand sign on them, and exhibited them, those heaps of boxes in the galleries. So the productionists,
and pop art
artists are guilty of mimicking this equation. Of identifying fully with the abstraction of capitalism, of fleeing into over affirmations of its blindness.
Они сверх подтверждают слепоту капитализм качественным разницам.
Enacting its worship of dead materiality to the full.
Они на самом деле не предлагают какую-то эстетическую альтернативу, а просто разыгрывают.
So they don't give any alternative. They just play out whatever's available without changing anything. So pop art literally equates the most beautiful palaces to mountains of Brillo pad boxes or soup cans to the night and fog aesthetics of the Nouveau realists. So if we go to the biennial of contemporary art, that's what we can see, speaking about technologically sophisticated things that were difficult to create, next to the things that were created easily from in different point of view. Maybe somebody commissioned it, nobody understands what the artist thought while creating this piece, and so all this rubbish is exhibited next to beautiful things. So we can see this equation all the time in front of our eyes.
So
we can see the form of aesthetic enjoyment, which is very like religious adoration, that just you just kneel before the new form of despotism and slavery. That's what it means.
Что вот с этими минимальными такими условиями для производства искусства? Вот может быть все.
So what about the minimum conditions for art production? Maybe there are these technological opportunities that help new things grow.
Невероятное открытие вообще, на невероятную возможность, по крайней мере, сегодня, которую мы все обладаем, поскольку у нас есть интернет,
so we all have the internet and we can have a chance to look at the greatest masterpieces that people could never see in the past. We can see any film at any time.
Потенциально очень подробно рассматривать произведения старого искусства.
We can look at all the details of old art, trying to clear them from the dirt of the past. But at the same time, we can see, we can look at the internet as just heap of rubbish. So
the
horrible of the world and the beautiful of the world are, it's all exhibited like ephemeral elements that become the elements of public adoration.
So
the question that Lifshitz asked, his time is still here.
Он видел только через общественные изменения. Он не верил, например, что при капиталистическом обществе вообще что-то может меняться.
He never thought that something could change in a capitalist society. He thought only proletariat revolution could bring some changes. So only this could give the way for new flourishing of art. So this makes us think what we should do with this and how we should take all these things. And I don't have the answer.
В прошлый раз, кажется, Слава Алёшин задавал вот этот вопрос. Как вот этой измененной общественной ситуации, да, Лифшиц жил во времени, когда можно было верить в этот фундаментальный прогресс общества. Ну, перед таким большим вопросом, но всегда есть возможность хотя бы субъективно понимать это про себя.
So
всегда есть возможность
there is at least a chance to understand this objectively, because if you just work with
fetishism,
it's one thing. If you admire some artificial things, it's not the same as some real stuff. So we should do something in order to make a soup can speak. Thank you. And now I would be happy if you asked me questions, or objections, if you have.
Я смотрел, что все, все, кто слушали эту лекцию,
I noticed that everybody who was here, who was listening to our lecture, were looking like a rabbit.
К Лифшицу это довольно сложное испытание, я понимаю.
So
Давид исходит, читая лекцию, из того, что
I understand how difficult it is.
Прекрасно знают, о чем идет речь во всех этих текстах.
Everybody knows what Lifshitz wrote about, probably.
И,
so just to make things easier.
Конкретно вот то, о чем, все, о чем говорил Давид, с нашим временем. И понятно, что весь наш интерес к этим текстам и
draw comparison with our time, because our interest in these problems does not have historical nature. It's related to today's life. Several years ago, the exhibition, the Romantic Realism exhibition, closed. So This was an exhibition that provoked great discussion in professional environment. I've never seen so many writers writing fundamental analysis of an exhibition. And this exhibition was very popular. It was visited by 190,000 people. The numbers were bigger than those numbers of people who visited Serov's exhibition. So, something that was called totalitarian art during Perestroika brought a lot of interest. So, so the problems of the 1930s are coming back. So try to figure it out without Lifshitz's theoretical texts. You get back to Glamstock's texts about totalitarian art. So, this art that became so popular among broad audience, what does it mean? When Marx and Lifshitz were rejected during Perestroika time, everybody thought that we began to live in harmony. We began to became closer to the Western values. But what is happening now? The biological hostility of nations. That's what we can see when there are so many clashes, and it's not about class struggle. It's about one country trying to devour the other, or maybe one, just one country want to devour the rest of the countries. And we can see the quotations from the 19th century that Russia has no ally apart from its fleet and army. So all these is part of Lifshitz's text. So why are we dealing with it? Because there hasn't been any more analysis that would be as interesting as Lifshitz did, because it covers all kinds of problems, not only the exhibitions that take place here in Moscow, and other things that are called geopolitics. And now let's get down to your questions. Please be brave if you have any. You're welcome to ask.
David,
you said that you should abandon private property. I think I made a mistake. You should overcome private property for new selfless relations that make art possible. So art is impossible in the context of private property. That's the essence of Marx's aesthetic views. He thought that capitalism, the system based on private property, is fundamentally hostile to art. Art won't die because of developed technologies, for example, because of photography that makes you forget about painting. Art dies when only egocentrical, brazen, selfish,
какой-то проблемы, потому что все равно все подчиняется законам ценностей,
because everything obeys to the law of abstract value created by money.
Когда человек думает о том, сколько он будет зарабатывать деньги этим новым
произведением, when a human being thinks about how much money they will make by creating a piece of art, this artist will never create anything. And that's a trick of modern artists. They pretend that they don't think about it.
And
another Marxist term is very important, the division of labor. You pretend that you live during antiquity, so you make unselfish works, whereas the other person sees only money. So you show Rembrandt work and all he sees is just money. Can it exist without fetishization? If you can imagine the market outside private property, then I guess it is, but the market is just a form of exchange. There's nothing wrong about exchange. Exchange is a good thing that makes people share things. But selfless act is different from making money, because money doesn't really have any use. It's not useful. For example, if ruble is devaluated rapidly, like real devaluation, when you really can use it to wipe your ass. So you'll see that money is useless. But don't you think it adds something to the artist, some instruments? Money can add instruments or technologies to the artist. So this is what we talk about. It's an obstacle to real art use.
Без преодолевания частной собственности.
Речь не шла о том, что хотят ограничить художника старой
Wasn't about limiting the artist with their tools and technologies. New tools does not hamper the art process. It does broaden your possibilities. But the question is about the price. You get the tools, but you are made to abandon many other things. So why have I chosen this text? Why have I turned to it? Because you can see that Lifshitz is not a conservative person entirely in a conventional sense. It's not that he says that you have to paint with tempera. Film and photography is shit, so you shouldn't be a photographer or a filmmaker. He speaks about the conservative use of means. So it's how art should work, what it should express with regards to reality. Lifshitz is a realist in a deeper sense. He believes that the portrayal of reality is the most important thing, and in order to give a true depiction of reality, you can't do it for profit. So
вводит частная собственность, да? Когда ты видишь только
And private property is
cartoon, типа, тоже тех же 60-х годов,
something
да,
that impedes this process.
Видит везде
like
деньги,
Donald да, Duck's uncle used to see only дерево, money everywhere. Деньги. For example, there's a tree, but he sees only money. There's a house, but he just sees money. So the price tag on everything. You shouldn't look at life like this in order to portray it in its real wealth. Could you introduce yourself?
Да, Давыдов Игорь.
Игорь Давыдов.
Ну, во-первых, собственно, тут на деньгах еще и рисуют иногда. В 20 веке в конце был человек, который рисовал на деньгах, даже изобретал.
Some people like drawing on money.
Уже умер недавно.
And one вот. Of our emigrants, artists, used to draw something
Давида,
on
banknotes. Очень все верно, и David, это потрясающе, что, собственно, эта площадка was, в данном месте, это все звучит
right.
В начале 21 века,
that,
чему никогда бы не
this,
назад, например. А единственное, два момента по восприятию,
the
собственно, Михаила Александровича. Первое, is, он не был утопистом. Вот то, что он говорил, это глубоко научный подход. Именно с помощью науки он это все и видел.
Deeply scientific approach of Mikhail Lifshitz. So it's not an abstract utopia. He was studying, he was researching things, and then he described them, because, you know, some people say, oh, the left didn't really do it well, so let's introduce some abstract utopia and just lead the people astray.
Да, и второе, что статья, почему я не модернист,
the article, why am I not a modernist,
в литературной газете, да, вот,
It was published in литературная газета, literary newspaper. So the Crisis of Ugliness was published as
советских номенклатурных исследователей, ученых,
turning point
которые сказали,
of
что
the
мы
party,
защищаем современное искусство. Вот, среди них оказался святой
so,
русский Дмитрий Лихачев, который Дмитрий, потом там требовал Лихачев, у Пушкина вынимать из собрания сочинений всякие антирелигиозные пошлости, да?
Wanted to remove anti-religious things out of books. But then later he was awarded and considered a saint during Yeltsin time.
Да, противников поддерживать, не дает ему ответить в газете.
So,
да? Вот как-то странно получается, консервативный поворот Советской партии,
turning point of the Soviet party, but then the conservative person who was called the ideologist of social realism was banned. So this wording is not exactly right. It just happened that in the early 60s, up to 1964, Mikhail saw that the catastrophe, that the disaster for the person was not about conservatism, it was about pseudo-free avant-gardism, because it alienates a person from reality. As to the other conservative people, they followed the same rules as feudalists.
Буржуазные демократы, которые формально оказываются даже иногда человечнее и демократичнее их. То же самое, кстати, будет потом в советской номенклатуре при современной России.
Happened later
вот
during modern time Russia. So he began to fight.
Режиму, который сменил Хрущева в 68 году, подавляет Пражскую весну. И нужно как-то это обосновать. Они обосновывают это Берёвск. А те люди, которые это обосновывают, сами уже внутренние модернисты. Те люди, которые были бывшие там рабочие, сталинисты, они уже перекрасились, они уже обратны. И они уже для себя уже все защищают и продвигают. Потом ритуально приседают, а он как бы хочет открыть
had to protect
правду,
that, whereas Lifshitz wanted to discover the truth, to reveal the truth.
Вот, который, мне кажется, надо. Вот это дополнение So I think it's important to
add this, otherwise it would look like a liberal propaganda, that, you know, we fight for freedom, and we have Yuri Davidov, Ермилов, who is fighting for freedom. Then there's a film dedicated to Marietta Shigenyan as an apologist to modernism. So those historical references are important. Thank you very much. That's a valuable comment, especially with the conservative turn. It's just some people read his books in one way, some others were reading it in a different way.
And
the Soviet establishment circles were offended with that radicalism. As to utopian nature, I actually would question that, because in his autobiography of Idea, Lifshitz was sharing his views that he had in the 20s. He said that he was very naive and possibly utopian. So he said that directly. And if you... if you search why Lifshitz is interesting for artists, practitioners inside the modernist system, you'll see that there's the openness of a positivist system. If you...
Мне кажется, что эта открытость мне просто других слов, честно говоря, не хватает,
see
да,
this.
Чтобы, потому что это нельзя сказать, что
how open it is, and I can't say that it's a return to naive realism of the 19th century.
Это в своем роде некое ретроактивное, тотальное
видение искусства, retroactive total vision of art in a way that can generate
новое, а не на показ
something really new,
чтобы демонстрировать, например, технический прогресс,
not you know, pseudo progress, not a pseudo radical form.
Но мне кажется, термин утопии, то есть вот если мы вложим в утопию скорее позитивные,
if we think about utopia with positive connotations, something that's accepted in the social discourse, then it would give us something, because there is hope. We hope that nothing has yet been lost, and it can be that art can be restored, but not as a post art.
It's art
that we talk about. And after this change of human culture that took place during capitalism development, that there's this hope that the art can be restored. It's a desperate hope, but and maybe utopia is not a wrong word, but we use scientific approach and not intuitive approach, and it's good that you noticed that. As a friendly criticism, we stick to Marxist terminology, and utopia is a negative concept in the classical Marxism. So I agree with Igor, the speaker, because this term, damage utopia, has become part of our the vocabulary, so it doesn't really make sense to fill it with a different meaning. And your comment was absolutely right that Lifshitz's opposition during 1966 and 1968 was not the statement of an official position.
But it was perceived
by the public as the statement of a public point of view.
But
it wasn't like this. More than that, it was alternative both to official point of view and underground point of view. So it was against everyone, very vulnerable, but the most powerful position.
Как бы вы позиционировали, Андрей? Как бы вы позиционировали, собственно, позицию?
How would you position
Lifshitz относительно модернизма?
Position with regards to modernism? Is it imminent?
Так, это был вопрос.
Oh, it's a good question.
Я бы все-таки сказал, что до какой-то степени она имманентна, если вот смотреть просто на генезис, да, это не тот человек, который как бы как традиционный мыслящий человек,
как бы
пришел, смотрел на каких-то людей, как он не понимает, и как на других, как бы, и говорит, вот они
It's not that he was looking at people that he couldn't understand and said, oh, they're doing some shit. This was a person who got his education at Vkhutemas. He knew different art practices. And he had to study modernist approaches during his foundation year. So he knew it from inside, and he valued it as a public symptom, as a social symptom.
Нельзя сказать, что Лифшиц модернист.
But you can't say that Lifshitz was a modernist, because he has a very powerful and radical differentiation. He was making a difference between himself and others, and he gave very strong argument, so he was beyond the boundary of that system, and so it makes him very different from other modern critics of modernism, like Hans Zeldermeyer,
who was anti-clerical, but
Modernism is criticized for losing the mean, whereas Lifshitz was more radical. He criticized modernism for lack of radicalism. He said that it was one-sided, not dialectical enough, not total enough. So.
Но она крайней тоже нельзя ее называть, потому что она как раз крайность в системе мышления Лифшица, однобокость, да?
So
попытка как бы быть, условно говоря, и там, и сям, но не потеряя, тоже, мне кажется, что все-таки, извините, пожалуйста, за сейчас вот опять будет синдром удава, да? Пожалуйста, не пугайтесь, но есть такой гегелевский термин «снятие»,
so there's который очень хорошо «aufhebung» на
немецком языке, или «sublation» на английском языке. «Aufhebung» значит «снятие», с одной стороны, скажем так, отменить, с одной стороны, а с другой стороны, сохранить.
On one hand, but preserving, on the other hand. So Hegel had this idea, whenever you deny something, whenever you negate something, it does not disappear, it remains there inside. So Lifshitz had this aufheben of modernism, so he negates it and preserves it at the same time. And this is that makes him interesting for many artists like Comer and Melamed, who are conceptualists. And so while reading Lifshitz, they saw the guideline of negativity towards art that was much closer to the negativity of the first modernists that could read it, even though the author negated those modernists, so he codified
that negation. So
Lifshitz is internal integral criticism of modernism. It's not only about Vkhutemas students that were fighting their teachers. When he came to Vkhutemas in 1923, it's a very important fact. Not a year earlier, not a year later. What is 1922? It's a completion of modernist project, the completion of Dada project, the completion of suprematism, the beginning of global turn towards neoclassic. So all the opportunities were exhausted, all the revelations were made, and now you're going to study using the new canons. That's what the teacher said. So it's a very dubious situation. And the person who made the only radical conclusion was Lifshitz. So we can get rid of the iconostasis, meaning the teachers that were teaching at Vkhutemas. So he was, this was a very tough turning point. And like Marx used to say, if you think about criticism, you should cover the previous criticism, so the critique of critique. Of critical criticism. So this aufheben, the Hegelian term of removing, is a right thing.
And
it's right reading of Lifshitz, and very few interpretations of Lifshitz texts haven't really reached up to this point, up to this idea, and this is the only opportunity to read it deeply, to get this in-depth idea. And speaking about the thinkers that resonate with Lifshitz, there are some figures that come quite close in their wording, but not entirely. For example, Carl Einstein, you probably heard about this theoretician of cubism and surrealism. So he wrote a book against modernism in the 1930s. So it was extremely radical. It was full of hatred against the system that shaped. So, but it wasn't as subtle as Lifshitz's text.
Вот из из лагеря настоящих консерваторов такого как бы в помине нет, и скорее все так называемые консерваторы, если смотреть глубже,
but,
набор, скорее,
if we take a look at other conservatives, then it would be only about eloquent phrases. And if you read his manifesto, Why Am I Not a Modernist?, you won't be able to find as expressive manifesto in the 20th century. So it's a continuation of the most radical manifestos written in the 1910s and 1920s. And we have zero between those two. So there's a gap. Nothing like this has ever been written. Could you introduce yourself? I'm Yegor. Hello. I think that the question of style is very important. The way Lifshitz writes his text is not typical of Hegelian scholar or Marxist scholar. He is interested in German philosophy, and he is writing this speculative treatises, and these texts are antagonistical, polemic in nature, sometimes publicistic. So I'm interested in the genealogy. How was Lifshitz writing?
And
There are some comparisons with Nietzsche resentment.
It's interesting
that Lifshitz was dealing with the automatic codification of Marx's system, even though he never wrote such treatises of collective nature, so to say. Well, first of all, I would like to say something about German philosophy, interrupted by the worldly spirit. I think
the
German philosy is not just about speculative system. For example, Hegel that wrote the text Who Thinks in an abstract way, and that's it's full of polemics and radicalism. Of course, such texts as Брюмьер and others,
and
Marx's texts are very different from systematic materials. For example, Hegel's Aesthetics was written by Kodal, and he systematized the works of many people.
And
Hegel loved the word Scheisse. Shit. So it appears
a
term, well, maybe not in in his aesthetics, but anyway, or, you know, some folk expressions, all cows are gray, so this radical withdrawal from pseudo-correct language.
So you can find it there.
Another thing that we were discussing before the lecture, when Lifshitz was working on the translation of Hegelian aesthetics, he wanted to move from literal aspects and make it similar to Gerson, Belinsky, or Chernyshevsky. Works. So the language of that critique was a great benchmark for him. And as to Nietzsche, Lifshitz never shared anything with him because he was one of his enemies. And Henri Bergson was someone who he considered an inspiration for fascism, so he saw it as a reflection of decomposition period of time and the decline of philosophical tradition. So I wouldn't say and wouldn't construct any points that would bring Lifshitz closer to Nietzsche. I would like to make a comment. Lifshitz tried to write such a treatise. He tried to create a system to systemize his ideas, but he failed. In the last years of his life, he said that my system had been created, all I have to do now is to put it down. But as to Nietzsche, he had a phrase. So he said, I didn't want to make it to the history as a Marxist Nietzsche, as an aphorism, as a note, but that's what happened, in fact, because Lifshitz's system is published as notes from that incomplete treatise that was taken out of 700 folders of his archive documents. But the question can be formulated in a different way. Is there such a system? Because what Lifshitz did with Marx, for example, is there a book where you can find Marx's system? No. There was one incomplete work that Engels had to work through, so this book hasn't been written, and sometimes history doesn't give you a chance to create a complete system. Marx has a wonderful phrase. When we were offered to write a text on one English crisis, he said, oh, it's too early, a crisis hasn't yet saturated, so I can't saturate it yet. And when Hegel, I can't consume it. And so when Hegel appeared, you know, the end of philosophy, the end of art, the end of the world spirit. So this situation with Lifshitz was quite different because he was the beginner. He was beginning a new system. Speaking about the society of consumption, it sounds utopian. When Lifshitz was writing about the situation, he compared it with the time of late Rome. So it was not about 10, 20, or 100 years. If you take a look at the situation that developed over 200 and 300 times, it would look absolutely different. So then the time to systemize would come. And trying to outline the system from Lifshitz's text about genetic codes, it's possible. As to Spinoza, he wrote ethics. Why not writing aesthetics? So there is the system in his beautiful text. You have just to be careful while reading it.
Да, пожалуйста.
То есть один из...
One of Hegelian followers, Marx Dvořák, not historic, wrote a book, The History of Art as the History of Spirit. And in your system and Lifshitz's system, do you think the concept of spirit can be the subject of art, or is it secondary? Comes after other things. Sorry if it sounds very the question like on the surface. Lifshitz always uses the term of human spirit, but he means different thing. As compared to Hegel, Lifshitz thought that Hegel was a proto-Marxist. He was not speaking about abstract human spirit that would come like a divine spirit. Hegel used the spirit in order to speak about collective consciousness, about a collective phenomenon that can go far ahead of the pace. So, like speaking about this deterministic term of the pace that defines the superstructure, you can't find this in Lifshitz's works. This collective consciousness can go far ahead, and historically Lifshitz could find many examples to illustrate this point, but there's always this regulatory point of reality, and there's punishment if you go too far ahead. So reality is not about production
or
economism. It's the it's about the effect of different different turbulations of social consciousness. And Lifshitz thought that Marx interpreted Hegel and Hegelian spirit in the right way. As a translator who translated Lifshitz's text, I can say that it was extremely difficult to translate, for example, spiritual culture or from the spirit point of view. In English there is a very direct boundary between metaphysics
spirit
and reality. Like spirit, you know, sounds like, you know, this seances when mystics come together and try to call the spirits. Whereas in German, this guys means just mental. And his whole theory of ideas and ideals indicate this. And there is a work dialogue with Milenkov, another Soviet philosopher, and it's related to the previous question. So if, for example, you want to find this system, it's one of my recommendations. And he writes that the ideas and the spirit, this mental culture phenomenon, they do not exist just in a human mind. In a human head, it exists objectively. And, so we speak about objective materialism if we use Marxist terms. So he thought that the ideas had the same weight and were as real as material culture. So there's no primacy of machine over a person. Something that happens in your head is not just yours. It's universal, and even if it's extremely individual, still it's there. And if it's a spirit, it's not from divine, from divinity. It's a part of material life. So how can we understand the material life? It's a very interesting question. We could make another workshop related to Hegelianism in Lifshitz's works, because all the terms came from there. So if we had to compare him with Dvorak, it would be very interesting. Lifshitz didn't like this dualistic ideology, but he thought that the most important thing was to translate Hegel into language of materialism without losing any of his ideas. So whenever he spoke about human spirit, it doesn't mean the reduction, you know, this pseudo-Marxist reduction of spirit in relation to the base. He means that the space, the cosmos, is open to human consciousness in all the wealth of internal relations. So whenever we approach the infinity, we deal with spirit. So whenever we deal with the definitive, then we speak about the reduction to material things.
Происходит в пределах Маркса, но прочитанного таким образом, тут должна быть полная ясность, как никто не до Лифшица.
And so it's a very special kind of interpretation, and that's how Lifshitz did it. Marxists should take lessons not only from Hegel, but also from Plato, because that's an extremely original reading of Marx, which is
можно сказать, что
not like anything
платоновское
else.
Прочтение.
You can say that,
насколько сам бы Маркс удивился или изумился такому прочтению себя, это отдельный вопрос.
Maybe,
речь
Marx,
шла не про то, чтобы
we don't know whether Marx would be surprised or not if he saw this kind of reading of his works. But the most important thing is not what the person said objectively, but what his texts say objectively. So this is the way he read Marx, and maybe Marx himself would be extremely surprised if he saw that he
да, во-первых, не только в диалоге с Ильенковым.
Представляйтесь,
да, Сергей.
My name is Sergey. He had a dialogue with Ilyankov when we could see the Lifshitz tendency towards systematization, but also the work about poetic fairness, where he systematized the philosophy of ethics.
Это вот именно вот как можно увидеть, например, на текстах Лифшица по модернизму, если их читать друг за другом по времени. Скорее ему было свойственно схождение к конкретному, радикальной конкретизации, она созревает не за один день. Но у меня, наверное, вопрос такой возник, что вообще, насколько, как вообще идет период,
как вообще идет период
Лифшица на Западе? Вдевает ли они хоть какой-то отклик? Вообще, какой толк этот отклик? Что находят люди, что они видят? И видят ли они что-то? Много ли людей вообще заинтересованы?
to Lifshitz in the West? Are there many people that are interested in his works? Do his works get published? Lifshitz was translated into English in 1938. It was the only time. There were two texts that were translated and published in the newspapers in the 40s, but nobody reads those texts. He was received negatively in the 1970s in the West because he was considered an archivist. Nobody wanted to take him seriously as a philosopher, but in Germany the views onto him were different. He was published as some serious publications, contrary to conventional philosophy. So he has a different reputation in the German-speaking world. I started my major project on translating Lifshitz's works, like The Crisis of Ugliness, possibly some other texts. Also, I prepare the philosophy of art by Karl Marx and some other things. So, as a translator, I can say that I had different experiences. Being a supporter of Foucault, Danish curator jumped out of taxi in order not to hear about the big difference between Mozart and Sex Pistols, referring to Lifshitz. So whenever I started talking about Lifshitz, he would just jump out of the car. So it there's a lot of aversion. Caused by Lifshitz and
conformism.
You know, that curator is a conformist, so he had many doubts about Lifshitz. As to German speaking people, they feel that they need to investigate some more, to examine Lifshitz some more, because it hasn't been studied well enough.
And,
I guess the world spirit will interrupt us at any minute now, but we still have a couple of minutes left. We actually spoke together with David in different addressing different audiences in the US, in Germany, in the UK, and this figure is of great interest. The best expert in Lifshitz, Stanley Mitchell, a British science scholar, wrote two texts about Lifshitz that are known today in the English speaking world. So he described the situation in the following way. For example, Lifshitz writings about Pushkin, about literature, are extremely interesting, and all those texts should be translated. Of course, some parts, some blocks of his texts would never be understood, since they are dedicated to Писарев, to Белинский, and as to the third block, related to what Lifshitz wrote about art. You should just hide this text so that nobody could see them, because if they appear in English, Lifshitz's name would be buried. So it's prohibited to touch upon this works. And you probably know that
you know,
if you use Plato, Marx, you are a champion for totalitarian ideas, for large-scale narrative. So what comforts us is that we're living in the world which is about to collapse, and it's not a joke.
So
Popper's book was written after the World War II, was published in 1947, and the time is changing radically. So it will give the room to read Plato, Hegel, and Marx in a different way.
По-моему, у нас, да, по-моему, у нас...
Спасибо огромное всем за ваше...
Thank you very much.